This week on the Grassroots Podcast.
Someone said, what does health mean? To me, it's just three words, quality of life.
There is shops that have the, you know, chopped up fruit or the muesli or yogurt, but it's like $8.
I was just going to say that.
And the sausage rolls are like $1.50.
When someone goes into hospital, food is going to be the foundation to actually improve whatever condition that they've got. Yet the food is the worst quality you'll ever see.
I'm your host, Quincy Kennedy, and you're hanging out with us in Thought Fox Studio One, also known as the Fox Den, and we have the Suicide Squad here today. A full roster of some really cool people here. We got Matt, the Kid Lindsay, sorry for knocking your mic, from NSA Hockey. We got Jase from Alive in Nutrition, and a really special guest with us, Ellie, who is the social media guru behind the scenes, someone that you don't see all the time.
No, you don't.
Ellie, how are we doing?
I'm good. How are you, Q?
Good. You excited to be in the seat?
I am. This is the first time I'm doing it with you. I've done it with Matt when we were at Sports Fest.
That is right. You did. I was not in that show.
No, you weren't. You were a bit busy, weren't you?
I was. I was busy growing the brand.
You were busy running around behind us. I remember that much.
That's usually Jace's seat, and now Jace is sitting co-pilot.
Yeah.
I know.
Promotion.
Promotion.
Promotion. I'm pretty sure it'll be a very swift demotion.
I think Dave was the one telling me I was being demoted, and now he doesn't even exist. What happened?
I can't bet the European.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, hey guys, we got an exciting show for you. Miss someone what? I thought I'd just throw in a quick laugh just to play it off. Great show for you guys today. Super pumped what we got. This one's actually from one of our Earth movers. It's requested. But before we get into...
We do look at the feedback.
We do.
We do.
Actually, talking about feedback. We got some feedback from the Halloween episode. A lot of conversation going on. Shout out to all you Earth movers. Earth movers have spoken. That seems to be the tagline I've been seeing in social media.
Yeah.
The Earth movers have spoken. Have been summoned.
Works well.
It does. Every time you say that, we do something. So,
yeah. Keep the feedback coming.
Yeah, keep
please.
It going.
Yes, conversation is really good. Loving it. What do you guys think about the feedback, actually? We got some time. Let's talk about the feedback. What do you guys think?
I love that it's so positive. Generally, when you see feedback online, it's not that great. But ours is very positive and useful. People actually tell us what they want to hear from us. So, yeah, keep it coming.
No haters, no weeds out there yet.
No.
Yeah, I'm still waiting. Someone will have a paragraph somewhere just ready to copy paste that down. Yeah. I'm nervous for that day, but
there goes that 5-star rating.
Yeah, there it goes, right down. Yeah. Pow, right in the kisser.
It was always a bit nerve-wracking when you get the notification. You're about to read it. You're just like, oh, is it going to be good or bad? But
there's some people who really love that moment. That's how you know you've made it, when you get your first negative feedback.
Like, yes.
Boom. I've rattled someone's chain.
Yeah, a little bit of Gary Vee. Just like, I've made it. I've been accomplished.
It's kind of funny that as well, with feedback, you generally won't hear if you've done something well.
But you've done it wrong.
Yeah, they'll take the time out of their day, out of their life, to make their mark, just to get that little sort of gratification.
I'm a journalist, so I know all too well about that. So when someone does something nice for me or does something really good, I will acknowledge that, because I know on the other end, they just cop the abuse. So you tell them they've done a good job. It'll make their day, I can assure you. It's a tip for you. If you want to make someone's day, tell them what a good job they've done.
Absolutely.
You're a good egg, Elle.
I do try.
Well done.
I actually like how social media has given us the opportunity to just bash companies when they do a poor job.
Oh, yeah.
I do like that, because some companies have the worst customer service. And it's like, you know what? It's not acceptable. I'm going to get on your Facebook and I'm going to troll the crap out of you. You know? So, you know, I think it's
good.
It's
the way you get results these days.
It is. Yeah. You know? They respond real quick when you get on that Facebook wall. Or shoot out a tweet. They're done. They're all like, oh, excuse me, Mr. Kennedy, or Mr. at G Quincy Kennedy on Twitter. Sorry we missed that message from you, but we would love to give you an extra discount. Please just inbox us the rest of your conversation. We'll get back to you right away. Thank you, sir. But yes, right. That's what I thought, son.
Is that positive, though? I mean, you're kind of channeling the inner 2-year-old in the middle of the supermarket aisle, you know, getting what you want.
Having a tantrum.
That's exactly what it is. Yeah. Oh, that's awesome. Awesome. Let's get into it, guys. Q's word of the day, word of the week. I've been saying word of the day a lot. Q's word of the week. Feeling good for this one. This one in coalition. I think that's the right word. In correlation with today's episode, Word of the Week, health. We're talking about health, which is such a phenomenal word. There's so many areas of health. There's health physically, mentally, emotionally, health in your relationships, health in your relationships at work or at home, your health in regards to physical, working out, mental health, reading, I don't know, all the other stuff that comes along with health, being hydrated. I don't know. There's so many different ways that you can be healthier that we acknowledge health. And for me, I just think more of it is the mental health part of it, in regards to just personal growth, like always making sure I'm healthy, rather is physically making sure I am hydrated, making sure I am watching, you know, how much carbs I'm taking in or if I'm eating junk or how much fast food I'm taking in, mentally making sure I'm reading, making sure I'm reading some leadership books, some business books, even growing and being healthy and my relationships, making sure I'm investing in those friendships, investing in those relationships so that I can be healthy all the way around. So that's my take on health. What do you guys think?
Well, I think I focus more on mental health, my relationships, like that kind of health, rather than my physical health. And then I realize after a little while that I need to take care of my physical health to keep focusing on the other health sides of things, yeah, if you know what I mean.
Absolutely.
So yeah, I let my physical health slide quite a bit. I get very unhealthy with my habits. And while I'm focusing on other things like maintaining relationships, you know, and your reading and doing all the other sides of health, and then I start paying for it and I have to refocus those energies back into physical health.
Mm.
Yeah.
I think I go through stages, like you're saying, where I can focus on one thing and be very healthy, I guess, at that particular thing, but then I let other things slide. But in terms of Grassroots, like our NSA business, we are currently quite healthy, I think. And our Grassroots sport, our Grassroots sport of ice hockey in Newcastle is going very well.
Mm.
So in that sense, it's very healthy.
Health.
Chase, you're the health guy. You let us know what health is.
If someone said, what does health mean? To me, it's just three words, quality of life.
Ooh.
Mm.
That's what it means.
Got him, coach.
Yeah.
Do they teach you that?
Is that lecture one, day one?
That was actually, and it got repeated for the rest of them. Nothing like a bit of repetition to really drill that into you, but QOL.
Just snapping there? What's going on?
Just some live social media action.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
What's the scary side of
that?
My mugshot. That's terrible. I can actually see that right there, guys.
I'm debating if I should post that or not. I won't do that.
Don't
to you.
Do it. Don't worry. That is how you damage your healthy relationship with Jase.
Honestly, there's only one thing worse than a standard photo, and that's a movement photo for me. So.
Oh, no, that's awesome. Yeah, definitely. Word of the Week, guys. Health. Make sure you guys are staying healthy, both physically and mentally and with your relationships. It's always good to invest in all those areas of life because we don't maintain our health if we don't invest in it with time and money. So maybe that's buying a gym membership. Maybe that's buying some healthier food options. You know, all the expensive stuff is all the healthy stuff. I can't believe how expensive fruit is out here. That's just a side note. Like avocados, like...
Avos are pretty contentious.
See, Woolworths has that free little fruit basket at the front now, though. Just pretend you're a kid. I think it's got like kids eat, grab an apple.
So kids eat free, free ones all the time.
Oh yeah, that's why I keep shaving.
Oh man. So yeah, and invest in your mental health as well. Make sure you guys are buying books, listening to great podcasts that empower you, like the Grassroots podcast, and also into your relationships. Spend some money, go out on a date, go out with friends, hang out, spend some time.
Yeah,
try a Grassroots sport.
There you go. Or try a Grassroots sport, specifically lacrosse, if you guys are interested. There's also another sport, ice hockey, out there if you guys like. Guys, we're talking about, actually this is a requested from one of our earth movers, and it's specifically healthier options when you're on the road as an athlete traveling, eating out, fast food. I don't know how to exactly word the question. Do you guys remember how the question is actually worded?
I think it was basically the gist of it was just want some good options while you're on the road.
Healthy fast food options.
Healthy fast food options while on the road.
Yeah.
That's exactly it. Well, Jase, man, you are the guy to lead this conversation. You tell us what are the healthy options? I mean, like, I don't know, man. McDonald's, all their healthy vegan options, or Hungry Jack. I mean, all the fruit they sell there. tell us, what's the better option?
Oh, it's making the best out of the situation that you're in. So, guys, really jump on to the show notes as well. There's going to be a few resources up there just to detail some good options from different establishments. It's knowing your requirements and balancing out how much you actually need. So just think again, is that food and drink is your petrol, and everyone's got a different capacity petrol tank to what they need. Generally, fast foods are quite concentrated in petrol, which is where the problem comes from. It doesn't matter. We've got a menu here that I've just been reading through just to have a look of what they deem to be a healthier option. And you're going to see things like low carbohydrate. You're going to see things like vegan, gluten-free, dairy-free. The excess comes and it's calories. The food is just that concentrated in calories. People aren't moving to burn those calories, and we're way too efficient at putting those away and storing them as body fat. And then you get into the more nitty-gritty of things. You know, too much of the wrong types of fats. Fat equals flavor. Ask any chef. You know, you add fat to something, whether it be in a sauce, a soup base, a stock, whatever it might be, a cream, there's your flavor. Adding a bucket load of salt to it will amplify that flavor. Add some sugar to it, you add some depth to that amplified flavor. All those things in excess are not good. They're also cheap as well. So, yeah, food manufacturing will revolve around those types of things as well. So, it very much deviates away from the fresh fruit and produce that you'd actually go and buy from your supermarket.
So, tasty equals terrible.
That's pretty much what I got out of that.
Very true.
Just in summary.
Generally, if it tastes fantastic, awesome, as a general rule in life, be concerned.
So hospital food must be very healthy, because that's the most bland type of food I've ever had.
Oh, unbelievable.
That's so microwave. Like, that's like after I leave the hospital, after eating food, like actually cruise food, you think like they have the buffet, they have everything laid out. But I felt like I went into that. It was right after my wedding. So like I was ripped, like I was a G, right? So I go on this cruise like feeling good, right? We're in like Western Caribbean. Like after day 1.5, like my stomach was sticking out so far. It was so bloated. And I just felt such like crap the whole cruise. I couldn't stop eating because it was all free. Yeah.
But like, I feel like that comes down to portion size.
No, it was, I promise you, like it was just something different about the food. Like, just like it didn't taste processed. It tastes delicious. But I don't know what it was like, and I feel like it's the same with hospital food. Like, I just feel so gross. Like, anytime there's like that much quantity of something and stored in one place, I feel like it's not healthy.
Hospital food is the most anticlimactic thing out. So when someone goes into hospital, food is going to be the foundation to actually improve whatever condition that they've got. Yet the food is the worst quality you'll ever see. It's all built on a budget. Cost, mass produce. They put very little effort into the food budget as well. So from working in a hospital system, that's the most frustrating thing, because the menu is what you've got to work with. And apart from pumping down a commercial supplement, a shout out to all the companies, I won't mention names, but the second ingredient is going to be a cornstarch or a thickener. And just draw the parallel back to cattle, and what's the easiest thing to fatten up cattle pretty quickly? Corn. Really? So to keep weight on people.
Do they think we're going to get health like better in hospital because they fatten us up?
Well, basically, like your prognosis rapidly gets a lot worse if you actually start to lose weight. So the main priority is to stabilize weight for a lot of patients going towards a state of a malnutrition, because you don't have the building blocks to maintain weight. You won't have the building blocks to improve whatever condition that you've got.
Don't they put that much thought into it? Why don't they just make it better and make us happier? Because doesn't happiness equal wellness?
Happiness equals expense. It's got to be cheap.
Of course.
It's got to be cheap.
Are the private hospitals better than public?
Actually, they're worse.
That's not ideal.
They're actually worse. And yeah, I've seen both sides of that one. So yeah, no, if you ever get taken to a public hospital, depending on which one, I wouldn't be stressing too much about that.
Right.
Yeah.
I was going through your show notes earlier, and what stood out to me was portion size. How can I better? Because I love to eat until I get that sick feeling.
Yep.
At that point, I'm like, okay, I can't eat anymore. I must be full.
Absolutely.
How do I train myself against that? Because reading those show notes, it seems like, I'm actually eating way too much.
Absolutely. So it's mindfulness. Easiest way is to work on the palm size of your hand. So if you've got some sort of a meat size, a protein size, the palm size of your hand to start with for that. If you're looking at any starchy carbohydrate, whether it be bread, rice, pasta, again, use your palm size. But the things that are looking at your vegetable base, and these are things that are non-starchy. So like if you're taking your potatoes out of things, taking out corn, peas, things like that, have a decent starch content, therefore have a decent calorie content. You've got unlimited rain on those, but you're going to be very hard pressed to find that at your service station. Very hard pressed, which is where people are going to run into trouble, I think, more so than anything as well.
I think that brings us back to the question about like what options can you consider if you're on the road, you're traveling with your sporting team, you're going to your fast food stops. Like, what do you do?
I'm just trying to think as holistic as possible. So think something like a sandwich. If there's a natural yogurt there with maybe a little bit of a muesli or a granola on top, just think natural nuts, seeds, trail mixes. Anything can be in excess. Absolutely anything. You can go overboard. But things like pies, hot dogs, sausage rolls, deep fried foods, dim sims, Dagwood dogs, you name it, whatever it might be.
That's what kills me. Sorry,
go ahead.
To butt in, but we're in airports all the time during the winter, and there is shops that have the chopped up fruit or the muesli or yogurt, but it's like $8.
I was just going to say that.
And the sausage rolls are like $1.50.
And they fill you up.
Exactly. And we don't get
that. That's the cheap thing as well. Well, that's the cheap thing. And there's a huge movement, and a lot of dietitians are the same thing, where foods that are processed are a lot cheaper, and we want to see a tax put on those to be able to subsidise the fresh fruit and veg.
Yeah.
And like the prices are not what this farmer's being paid. It's more often than not the supermarket that's putting 300% and 400% on them. The farmer's the one getting a raw deal at the end of the day. So look after the farmer first and foremost, so we actually have some.
You know what's crazy? This is a side note. I go on these side note, these tangents. But like we're talking about health, right, in Australia, and we're talking about what's the better options. But coming from the States, like Australia is so much healthier. Like even just the crap that's put on foods, like GMOs and all that other fun stuff. Like you guys won't accept our food the way we eat it.
Oh, God, no. There's some massive exceptions to that. So high fructose corn syrup, look at that. And if you go over to the States, Coke is generally going to be far, far sweeter than what you have here.
Exactly.
And even if you have it over in America, because that high fructose corn syrup is like five times sweeter than what sugar is. But again, coming from corn, really, really cheap to produce rather than, say, a cane sugar. So the expectation in America, everyone's got such a sweeter palate because there's so much sugar within their foods. Even if it's a salty food, you could have an absolute bucket of sugar in there and not know it because there's so much salt in there, it's actually masking it.
Absolutely.
So you've got the taste for it. That's what people expect. And that's the way it is. But you'll notice the difference if you actually do go back over there. And you would have, coming back over here, noticed the difference that way.
I did notice a big difference. Even the McDonald's, I was like, even the options and the portion sizes, I felt healthier. Even just coming from the States, like one McDonald's to another, I felt healthier being here.
It's a whole supersize me analogy as well.
Oh my goodness, man. Like everything is massive in the States, and you don't realize until you come here. Like the first few months I was here, I was still hungry. Like it was that feeling. It's like, and like,
I don't feel sick yet.
Yeah, I don't feel sick yet. I don't even feel full yet. Like I haven't hit stage one yet. And it's, like, especially when we go out with friends or someone invite us over to eat, we're the new guys in the country, so people invite us over to eat, and like, it's almost like I almost felt like they were being rude to me, because it's like, really, that's all?
Like, where's the rest?
Where's the rest? And then, like, usually, like, at home, there's always leftovers, and you always have, you know, you can always go back for second or thirds, but here, it's just like, it's one plate and done. Yeah. Yeah. And then you're washing the dishes. It's like, ooh, struggle bus.
It's so, a cultural element to that, culture, too.
Yeah, exactly.
Absolute culture element there.
And so, yeah, I mean, that's just the big difference in itself right there. But mentioned earlier what you were saying about, like, the palate and the taste. Even going from me and my wife recently, went, well, she's always been gluten free because the whole celiac thing. But we recently went vegan. Well, she's been vegan, but I recently went vegan, and like, just the rawness of food that we eat now, like, your palate starts to change. Like, before, I'm like, oh, that's completely disgusting, gross, no flavor. But your palate actually changed pretty quickly. I think it took me a week or two, and now I actually prefer like a vegan, I don't know, mama pea, I don't know, raw ingredient protein ball thingy that's like $10 too much over a candy bar. And it's weird now, like, how my palate has changed, and I'll prefer that over something super sweet.
You do adjust to it, and there's one part of your palate that is actually not died off, but it's kind of laid dormant for a lot of people. It's the bitterness. People can't handle bitterness. So if you take any sort of a leafy green, chard, spinach, kale, you know, try having that a raw and come back from it, and you know, there's a good way to limit your portion control. You're not going to want it much of it. I think honestly the biggest thing, the best part that they've done, is to put the kilojoule or calorie rating on foods to know what things are actually worth. But you've given people the tools, but not actually shown them how to work out what their requirements are. Like, everyone's individual.
Yeah, all of a sudden, all these kilojoules, readings came up on all the food, but people had no idea what that was for. Like, I worked in hospitality at that time, and we were required to do that. And then people were like, "Well, what does that mean?" So then we had to put up like a crappy little sign that said, "You know, the average adult intake is,"
and it's like,
in three different window fronts, it's three different numbers. So, I don't think people fully understand what that's all about at all.
No, they created a problem because they've given everything a numerical value, and then everyone's gone to the next question, how much do I need? They don't have the capacity to go in and tell everyone how much they need. So let's just get the average Joe, 70 kilo male, and work out what the average is for him, because we're all the same, right? And that's going to work out. But, I mean, the easiest way, like, everything's based on numbers. Everything's an equation. So, inherently, as an estimate, there's a little bit of error going to be involved. So, whether you're working in calories or kilojoules, they're exactly the same thing. They're basically the measurement of how much petrol is within a food. So, get your current body weight, times it by 20 calories or 80 kilojoules. That's the same amount in equivalencies.
Per day?
Per day.
Say that again. What is
it? So, 20 calories or 80 kilojoules. I prefer to work in calories because it's a smaller number.
Likewise.
So, let's just say 20 calories.
Yes.
For instance. And let's just say Q over here is 100 kilos of muscle.
I would say you're pretty accurate.
Zero body fat.
0% body fat.
Oh.
Picture of health, and that's the segment today. But, you know, 20 calories times 1 kilo or every kilo of his body weight there, so there's 2,000 calories. So what that number will represent is something called your base metabolic rate. How much fuel your body requires if you literally did nothing all day. That keeps your organs functioning. That maintains your muscle mass as well. Any activity you do on top of that, this is where it gets very individual, is additional.
Right.
So that's base requirements. Very, very crude in the way that it's done. So as an example, I've got a lovely menu here from the guys at Grilled. Shout out to Grilled. But just to say that you went and, you know, had some of their regular chips, which are... How good do they taste?
Oh, pretty good. Freaking amazing.
I've got to say, there's a lot of salt on those chips, though.
Oh, they're so delicious, though.
Because it deepens the flavor.
Delicious. Bad for you.
Cold.
A regular serve of those is 400 calories straight away. So if you're having the chips and then you had a burger on top of that,
yeah,
which most of them are around about the 400 to 500 calories, so you know, you're up to about 900 calories. Yeah. You have a drink on top of that, and Q's just laid in bed all day.
Yeah,
he only needs 2,000. That excess probably isn't going to go where you want it to, mate.
it goes straight to my hips every time.
A moment on the lips, a lifetime on the hips.
Oh, that's exactly it, man.
So that's a lot of maths, and my job is maths, really. The individual variation is where I have to work out how much activity someone's doing. Maybe they might need less. Right. If they've got a condition, it might be a disease state. Maybe their lung function's extremely shot, basically, because they've been smoking for 20 or 30 years. They've got to work a hell of a lot harder just to breathe. So their requirements are so much greater. And that 20 calories per kilo can jump up to 30, 35, even 40. So one of my contract jobs is actually within an aged care facility, and people there, low body weight, lying in the one spot all the time. They're supposed to be rotated, but nursing staff, you know, don't always get around to them.
Mm.
They get things called pressure sores, where the bones actually start to press through the skin. Those things are nasty. They take a hell of a long time to heal. And straight away, to heal that, you're looking at 40 calories per kilo.
I've had to clean one of those out before. It was nasty.
Really?
Yeah.
In a previous life?
On one of my placements.
He's actually an OT. A doctor, guys.
Yeah,
that's right. Not just weren't implants.
It was nasty. Yeah.
Yeah.
It looked so painful. It was deep, very deep down the bone.
Stage three. Yeah. That's as
so
as
food, hey?
But yeah. Food. Eating well will prevent you from getting that pressure ulcer, and also moving is a bonus. We don't want you sitting around for too long.
Actually, I just heard that too much standing can be just as bad as too much sitting.
You mean stationary standing?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, just think your heart's the biggest pump you've got. If you're pumping blood down to your feet, the only thing, well, the main thing that actually gets that blood back up through your veins back to your heart is a contraction of your muscle to bring that back up. So if you're just standing stationary, so these are the ideas of those standing workstations. You're just standing there. It's not necessarily a good thing. So you could have something like a deep vein thrombosis or something like that develop. So
that's why they created the treadmill ones. Standing
The sitting
exercise sections.
Absolutely. We're designed to move. So next time you see someone at their desk doing that, they're actually smart. They're not crazy.
Yeah.
A lot of the sit-stand desks have the option now. Yeah. They just like rotate it down and they tell you like every 2 hours or every hour.
A lot of cool startups that have done that.
Yeah. Switch it up.
There's all new kind of desks and for the creative person to work and the workspaces. Okay, so
were you surprised by that list, guys? You've actually had a sneak peek at that list.
Yeah,
is there anything on there that we're like, really?
Well, I'm thinking just because the guests can't see this.
Yeah, what do you
maybe I got a Ultimate Eating Out Takeaway Food Guy from Live and Nutrition. And so we're getting really practical here, guys, in regards to the question that was asked in the comments about, you know, what to eat, what's the best things to consume when you're on the road and traveling as an athlete, or maybe just traveling as an individual. Sidetracked. Even just traveling as an individual, maybe you're going and doing something. I don't know what you're doing, but you're traveling and you're eating out. So we got the Ultimate Eating Out Takeaway Food Guide, which would be in the show notes as well. But to answer your question, the thing I was most surprised about is that under a void, so we have better options in a void. So under a void, I see chicken nuggets from McDonald's. And why would I avoid the pure white meat of a chicken nugget? Like the protein is lean meat. I mean,
I'm not actually sure it's been verified to be chicken.
Well, like, so you, what,
your
what,
face they, is like, what? What is this blasphemy? God.
Do they just call it chicken nuggets? Huh? Huh?
I'll drop a bomb right now.
Well, I'm vegan anyway, so I can eat it, right?
Well, the old apple pies, they're not apple pies.
Well,
they're choco pies with apple sauce because choco is far cheaper.
I don't know what a choco
is. I feel that is serious. That's lying.
What is a choco?
What's a choco?
Google it.
I don't know if I want to.
I think
it's a vegetable. It's a very, very bland vegetable, starchy, can actually have the same consistency as an apple, but it's far cheaper because everyone basically throws them away. Mm. They call them a weed, basically.
Yeah, right.
And, not attractive.
Wow.
Not attractive whatsoever.
No.
So there's a
That's a fun fact for you guys.
There's a nugget for you.
So next time you think you're eating apple pie, you're actually eating some healthy vegetable called
choco.
Coated in apple-like sugar.
Yeah, that's right.
And a lovely, crispy, deep-fried buttering.
Oh, mm. Yeah.
What I noticed on there was it seems to be all the avoid options was beef.
Yep.
Yep. And chicken.
Some of the chicken was... Okay, grilled chicken.
Grilled chicken was all right. Yeah, deep fried. When you deep fry something, you're not being the best thing.
So what's the beef? What's the beef with beef?
Oh, the beef with beef. So as one of... Well, this is an interesting little story. One of my first jobs was actually fast food. So everyone's had the little stint of fast food.
Taco Bell. Shout out to Taco Bell.
Oh, I had, I had Burger King.
Did you have Burger King?
I had Burger King actually converted to Hungry Jack. It was the other way around. Anyway, there was a takeover at some point.
Yeah.
But everything stayed the same. Mm. We got, you had the two-size burger. So there was a 4-inch patty and a 5-inch meat patty. Mm. And once you had it cooked, you could actually store it for about half an hour in your Winston thing, which is like a heat generating machine oven thing. Anyway. It was very oily, and I was set the challenge to find out just how much oil was in one 5-inch meat patty. Mm-hmm. So I spent.
Do you want the result?
We do want the result. It took me a good 20 minutes of my shift. And, squeezing
time
the
life well, out of time this. Well used.
It was actually.
They paid you for that?
Unbeknownstly. But yeah, I squeezed the life out of it, and a large soft drink cup worth of oil came out of that.
That is
just
disgusting.
One 5-inch. It was a intense, you know, moment to get all that out of there. But imagine that.
Was that the pivotal point where you were like, I'm going to be a dietitian? I'm going to change the world. People need to know this.
It's like I'm going to sacrifice 5 years of my life now just to find out what that is. No. That was scary. But basically, the beef is the lowest grade. It's 100% beef, but, you know, it's what part of the cow that you probably don't want. Mm.
The bottom of the bottom of the foot.
100% hoof.
So talk to us about that. And I know Ellie's getting ready to come in with that fire. She has the packet in her hand, so I won't take up the time. But will you just explain the whole 100% beef thing? Like, because it makes you feel like you're getting something healthy. Like, they're good at marketing. That's what it is, right? It's marketing.
Oh,
but
absolutely.
Technically, they can't be lying. There has to be some rule. So like you said, it is 100% beef, but it's the lowest grade. So talk to us about that. Because even like when I worked at Taco Bell, like the beans was a powder that you had to mix really, really hot water with, and it clunked up and made beans. But like, you know, but like just random stuff like that. Like, so... Explain that to us. Is it 100% beef? Even like the chicken nugget thing. Like, I watched this awesome documentary on Netflix. Shout out to Netflix. If you want to sponsor your boy, I'm on here. Grassroots Podcast. Netflix, I need a special. I need a Netflix special. But there's a good documentary, and it shows like, it might have been the Supersize Me one. I don't know. Or maybe
that's
fed
a good
up.
Documentary, by the way.
Mm. Anyway, but they were showing like chicken nuggets being made, and it was pink goo. Like being processed. It was like literally pink goo.
Yeah, there's
a... You can Google that and see that. It's just like...
Pink slime, it's
pink
called.
Slime, yeah. But yeah, it's 100% pure chicken, you know? Like,
with pink slime.
Explain this to us, Jase. Come on. Give us the lowdown.
Well,
can they
there
say
is,
that?
There's part of the chicken in there, but you're not getting a lovely chicken breast. 100% beef. There's cow in there. yeah, we're just not 100% sure what. But it is 100%. Some part of that cow. So they're not lying, but they're making you feel that it's a good thing. Like there's nothing else added but beef in here. But there's a lot of part of the cow that you don't want.
But how do they get to look like so brown and beefy and like it's been grilled? Like how do they get...
It means anything, you're going to get a good result.
Yeah, very true.
Yeah. See, it worries me when I do see 100% on a fast food because I'm like, nah, what is going on in there? Why do you feel you need to tell me that's 100%? Because nah, I do not trust you immediately. No trust.
What if it was like 60%? Would you get it then? Like, yeah, they're probably telling the truth.
I'd feel that they were not lying to me, and I'd feel much better about that engaging in that fast food.
Much more honest.
Yeah.
Straight up line away. But no, it's you do the bare minimum in terms of labeling requirements to satisfy them.
Can I ask, you might not know, Jase, but what, who looks after all that marketing side of things, like what you do have to tell the consumer, what you don't, you can sort of get away with?
Fazans. Yeah, so Food Standards Australia and New Zealand okay. are the governing body. They've got people that do it, go out and do audits. It's pretty thin, though, in terms of who actually does the audits and if you're going to get caught.
Do they take complaints from the consumers?
Absolutely, and they'll investigate those complaints as well. Okay. So the higher profile obviously going to attract a little bit more attention for them to look at it closely. So if McDonald's bring out a new product, they're obviously going to look at it as if I go into the back shed and start mincing up something and, and call it Jason's Special Blend 100% something.
Still probably be healthier.
Exactly, but if they start seeing a trail of bodies from the shed, then they might start to look a little bit closer.
Jason's jagging people in the freezer.
That got dramatic really quick.
It really did, actually.
It was right after the Halloween episode, so we're all right, guys.
That works. You just need the handprint on the screen there as well.
It's like how you go to McDonald's, like they show the line now, so you see people making the food, and you just see Jace pulling a body out the freezer. He's waving at the customers.
It's okay, guys. It's 100%.
It's 100%.
I got locked in one of those freezers once, hey. It's pretty scary. One of the staff members locked me in the freezer. Oh, I was there for about 20 minutes.
Hilarious.
Yeah, it was a deep freeze one too.
Why didn't you say that one in the Halloween special? That's nice.
Yeah, I just remembered it. I thought that scarred me a lot more than it did. But.
That's fantastic.
But
wow.
Like labeling requirements, I mean, again, this grilled menu here, it's got gluten-free next to a lot of things. And that's one thing to say. If anyone's got any allergies or sensitivities, be very, very careful about reading the fine print. Gluten-free, it doesn't say it's safe for celiac. There's still the chance of cross-contamination in that fine print. So if you are celiac, which is the upper end in terms of sensitivity to gluten, which means that it's not dose-dependent, a little bit of a trace, and that can be using the same toaster, which they do, as their standard gluten-containing products, you're all going to have some issues with that as well.
Far out.
So it's that fine print. So they're saying gluten-free. They've got the disclaimer down there. But, you know, how many people are going to really read the fine print when you're hungry?
People who've had that experience more than once. When you get, I mean, you accidentally get a trace of gluten, I'm saying from experience, my wife, like, you're out, like, done.
Yeah.
For a good 24 to 36 hours, you're just in pain, just a mess. So, yeah, people start reading that fine print after you get screwed over a couple times.
Absolutely. And, like as I said, food labeling, like, it's great to put all these numbers on things. And like, if you know what your actual requirement is, I think that's fantastic. But at least know your base requirements. So, you know, get that 20 calories per kilo and just think, if I'm pretty, you know, sedentary, I'm sitting down most of the day, it's not going to be far off that. You know, if I'm going for a very strenuous run, I might be burning 500-600 calories for that hour. Whatever it might be, most things are in the realm of going between probably 200 to 600 calories per hour in terms of activity. Some can exceed that, and bigger people expend more calories when they're moving as well, because obviously you're moving a lot more mass around. So, you know, to carry those guns around Q, you'd be able to get around with a lot more.
Nothing, man. Like, I burn zero calories. Like, I have no idea what's wrong with me, dude, because when it goes to my hips, it stays there. Like, it doesn't go anywhere. I feel like I do so much, and it just stays there. Don't know.
Stays on the hips?
Stays on the hips, man.
When you just do bicep curls, it's not going to be.
See, but that's the thing. I don't do bicep curls. Like, all I do is my tricep. Like, my biceps are just big because my triceps are big, so it just pushes the muscle up. But
okay.
There's a little bit of science behind that. At least 2/3 of the muscle mass is your triceps.
You're right, and it's proven, as you guys see in the YouTube video. My triceps. I'm just kidding. All right. Anyway, so
fake arm syndrome.
Fake arm syndrome. That's exactly it. Actually, one time my friend played me so bad. So like, I was like, oh yeah, man. You ever get that situation where like your arm falls asleep in bed? I was like, oh, I lift so much weight. My muscles are so big that like my arm falls asleep when I'm sleeping. And he's like, oh yeah, yeah, I understand, man. And then like we hang out with them a couple weeks later. He's like, man, I was just laughing at you inside. Yeah. I was like, what the heck are you talking about, bro? You sound like such a tool. I was like, why didn't you tell me that when I told you this? But it really does happen. Like, if you get a good pump, like the circulation in your like in your arms, and you go to bed after the pump, because I used to lift at night, I'd get a good pump in and then like go to sleep, and like I would have to just literally sleep like this, or my arms would fall asleep. I'm serious.
Even if that's true, we're just laughing at you.
I know.
I'm sorry, man.
I'm not quite sure what to do with that one, but
I guess I just shouldn't be so strong, guys. Sorry. But moving on.
We'll break so much.
Break a curl bar.
I want to talk about pregame real quick.
Yeah, absolutely.
Especially on the road. There's a lot of times where we don't eat as a team and we'll have maybe half an hour to an hour to go on your own and try find an option. Out of the fast food options, I get that none of them are ideal.
Yeah, absolutely.
But if you kind of have to go to one of these things to get a quick meal in before you play,
yep.
What can you kind of recommend? Like,
well, definitely.
Are you thinking breakfast, maybe? Are we thinking breakfast?
No, usually around lunch sort of thing. Like, we generally play it kind of between 3 or 5 o'clock. So it's generally a lunch thing.
Yep.
But I did hear somewhere like the Mexican takeout stuff is okay. Like, what's the best option to kind of look for if you're trying to scramble around a city or...
Easiest way, deep fried is a big no-no. So I did the three rules of pregame nutrition on the NSA lacrosse. So you're looking at low fat, low fiber, and if someone has a real problem with eating before a game, it's going to liquid as well. So looking at low fat options, obviously I said deep fried away, going for white meats instead of red meats. They're also always going to be a lot less fat content. So chicken, fish is going to be a lot better digested. You want some carbohydrate in there as well. So sandwiches, wraps, absolutely fantastic. Thing that's going to get you in trouble in terms of the fat content is the sauce. It's always about the sauce.
Right.
So creamy sauces are a problem. If you're going something a tomato-based sauce, you're going to be far better. Let's do a bit of a case study. So last time that you went to a game, what were your options? And let's get the best one out of those.
All right. So generally in the cities we go, we've got Subway, small cafes that we generally will try to find that have sort of pasta or pizza options.
Yeah.
That's kind of the main one we go to.
Okay.
I know some guys have been known to go to KFC before.
Well, going off that list, KFC is a no-no.
Yeah. The 11 herbs and spices ain't going to save you.
Well, pretty much only the herbs and spices are good for you.
Yeah. Basically. Let's just say you're going to the pasta place straight up. So, again, tomato-based sauces. Creamy-based sauces are where the fat content is. Pesto bases is a heavy fat content. It's going to hold you back. The pasta's fantastic. For the carbohydrate content, if you've got some sort of it's probably going to be chicken for the white meat. You don't see too many fish pastas going around.
Yeah.
That would be the best option. Subway's fantastic. Okay. So I know poor old Jared from Subway had the standing in one leg of his pants, but he had one thing right. He went for the lower fat option,
and that
works well for sports nutrition pregame. The way to strip back the fat in the sub is to take off the cheese. And to look at what type of sauce. So an example of a good sauce would be something like the sweet onion chicken teriyaki.
Okay.
There's no fat content in that. There's a fair bit of sugar content, but hey, I mean, that's your petrol when you're going out to train. So if you went, say, the sweet onion chicken teriyaki, 6-inch maybe, I mean, if you can handle a bigger meal, you can have your foot long pre-game. As soon as I mentioned
we're
size,
queue goes up.
G-rated boys.
That's right.
Oh, that's terrible.
Sorry, there you are.
So talking about volume, salads. plenty of salads on there. Oh, Mick, our producer, actually lost it in the background.
Don't look at it.
So it's good.
But look at your beverage as well. Soft drinks probably aren't the best way to go at this point, even though they don't have a fat content and they've got that sugar content that's going to help you. Being a heavy carbonated beverage, it actually slows down digestion in your gut. So unless you're having a flat soft drink, I wouldn't worry about it. Maybe even a juice would be a good idea to add to that as well. The quantity of how much you have is very much, again, dependent on what type of activity you're doing, but also your base requirements as well.
So you're kind of ranking tomato-based pasta pretty high.
Absolutely, yeah, because there's apart from a little bit of oil that's going to be to bring the sauce together, it's by far the better
option. So you're saying, I guess, Subway after that? Or where's pizza fit into this? Not at all.
Pizza, if you're going for a thin crust and a veggie-based topping, the cheese, but it's where the fat content's going to come into it.
Right.
Very heavy. Tomato base is fine. as well. But yeah, pizza, you'll see as well in the show notes as well, the types of pizzas. But yeah, I mean, don't be afraid of carbohydrates beforehand. Mm. They've got down as well for grilled. One of the better options is to go for the low carbohydrate bun. Carbs aren't the problem. They're copping such a bashing. It's just calories overall. Mm. I mean, if you want to lose weight, I could put you on the Lamington diet and you can have one Lamington for the day and you're going to lose weight. I don't care what type of Lamington it is. You're going to lose weight because it's underneath your calorie requirements. I mean, they'd love me while they're eating the Lamington and hate me for the rest of the day. Yeah. But, I mean, anyone can literally write a very low-calorie diet and you'll lose weight. And that's why people go on such a restrictive diet. They'll eat their lettuce leaves, their carrot sticks, their celery sticks, and they'll lose a lot of weight to start with. But it's not sustainable. Gotta find what's sustainable.
See, like, I like to, so even at work, so I don't get a chance to have lunch at work, so I usually pack a trail mix, which is a healthier option than going and grabbing McDonald's or whatever. But yep. I still find, like, when I used to count calories, a trail mix has a lot of calories in it.
Absolutely. So a serving size of nuts just by themselves, those little 30-gram snack packs, is the serving size of nuts. And the same as dried fruit as well. A 30-gram snack pack of that is equivalent to a medium banana.
So really? I guess, what do you do? I mean, like, you're trying to be healthy, yeah. But, like, that little trail mix is not going to fill me. So yeah. Do I just, like, starve until I...
No, you go to supper.
Well, what my question to you, if I saw you a one-on-one capacity, would be what are your other options? And let's choose the best option out of that we can for that time.
Right.
What do you have around you at that point? Again, as another case study, like, what do you have?
A bunch of raw food that I have to cook.
Okay, apart from that, convenience options, what could you get?
Oh, you mean actually when I'm out?
Yeah,
absolutely. Even at home, like grass, dirt, seeds. I think this is the KFC right where I work, and then that's it. It's
you're better off eating the grass.
If you had to go to KFC and you wanted a good option, thinking about it this way, if you actually had some chicken, if you pulled off the skin... Because most of the oil content will be stuck into the skin itself. So you've improved the option. You've got a food content that's high in protein to start with. So it's going to make you feel fuller for longer.
Is it high in protein?
Yeah, it's chicken.
Is it chicken, though?
It is actually chicken.
100%.
They couldn't get away. It's 100%. And I will vouch for you, KFC, 100% chicken.
Okay.
So, yeah, I mean, that would be a better option from that as well.
Right,
yeah.
I wonder if they'd give you a discount if you say no skin.
Save the skin, save the herbs and spices. I just want the chicken.
Just the meat, please.
Those grilled wraps, though. Are a good option.
Oh, yeah.
They're fine. But again, if you're going down the road of needing something gluten-free, that's not going to help you because they don't have the gluten-free option.
Oh, nothing fast food. Like, that's not even an option. You don't get to have fast food if you're gluten intolerant.
But you could order it without the wrap, and they could do that in a container for you, the contents of the salad and the chicken. Oh. If you ask for those things at a fast food place, they will generally do them for you. Mm. But right. A lot of people feel kind of stinted when you get it's the same amount of salad that's on a burger and the piece of meat, and you still charge the same price because it's a pain in their backside. Mm. But, yeah, I mean, like thinking back to the training thing as well and games, something maybe for a breakfast option, tracking back to that, something to set you up for the day. Mm-hmm. So I've gone for things that we haven't really worried too much about, what type of speed this food's getting into your system, but something for breakfast if your game's at midday or later in the day, you want something that burns nice and slow.
Right.
So
can I say what we always eat and then
I'll critique it?
Yeah,
go for it.
Usually we'll always go to a cafe and bacon eggs.
That is definitely slow release.
So is that a good thing?
If your game's a fair way away, I don't think it's going to hurt you too much, but is there toast with that?
Yes.
Okay. If there's toast with that, you've improved the option as well. So setting up that carbohydrate base earlier for later in the day.
How good's that?
But what about something like a muesli or a porridge or something? So oats in general will have a lot more of a slower release profile. It's very hard with breakfast at cafes to do something.
Yeah.
That's a little bit slower release. You're generally going to have like eggs, avocado, are quite a heavy fat-based content as well. But again, if your game's a fair bit later away, that's fine. But make sure you're getting that toast in there as well to top up.
Do you guys have grits out here?
No.
No.
Hasn't really come over.
No?
No.
Mm. So what about, there's a couple of things I want to ask about. What about slow release breakfasts?
Yeah.
And what about Bertram Muesli?
Bertram Muesli, if you're using a skim milk in there to pull back that fat content, you've got the goodness of the oats in there. If you use, again, I'm going to put a brand name to this one, a Greek yogurt in there maybe. Chobani is by far the superior nutrient profile. So shout out to you guys as well.
There's a lot of free advertising we give to these guys.
There is a lot of free advertising. So, a free tub of yogurt long.
Right? Yeah, that's right.
Here.
That'd be great.
But, it's traditionally soaked in apple juice for your Bertram as well. I mean, again, considering when your game is, it's not so much of an issue as well. So that's going to be, because of the oat content in there, it's going to be a slower release breakfast. And again, if your game's a little bit later in the day, I mean, that's fine. Then if you've got some nuts and seeds on there as well, that's going to keep you sustained for longer as well.
Absolutely. So for our listeners, again, this Ultimate Eating Out Takeaway Food Guide for Live Nutrition is going to be in the show notes. But I just want to go punch for punch real quick for you guys who are listening, you're driving, and you're like, oh, I'm so hungry right now listening to this awesome, fantastic podcast by the Grassroots team. I want to pull over and get something to eat. Well, here's your options. For McDonald's, avoid. Avoid everything, especially bacon added to burgers, chicken nuggets, McDippers, like he said, or like Jay said earlier, dipping creamy sauces and crispy chicken. Your better option, nothing. Just kidding. McGrilled chicken burgers, grilled chicken snack wraps, filet of fish, warm grilled chicken salad, and garden salad. Extras fruit bag, breakfast English muffin with one jam. Won't go through everything. If you guys are thinking about Hungry Jack's, better option is a Whopper Jr., tender grilled peri peri burger, or wrap, chicken nuggets, water, of course, and plain ice cream cone. KFC, grilled strip salad, kids grilled mini wrap, nuggets. Oporto? Is that a place?
Yeah, my friend.
All right. Quarter chicken with no skin, garden and fresco, strip pack, small mashed potato, small coleslaw. Subway, mini sub or 6-inch roll or wrap, 6 grams of fat. No, that's too much information. Lots of salad. Salad options.
I think there's one underlying theme there. It comes back to the one thing that we had a bit of a laugh at. It's size.
Yes.
It's...
Size does matter, guys.
Size does matter. You heard it from Q first.
That's right. pizza options. Pizza with lots of veggies, Chinese or Thai, dishes with lots of vegetables, and steam or boiled, small portions, and steamed dim sums or short, long soup or entrees. Sumo salad. Love sumo salad. Plenty of green leaves and salad vegetables, plus a serve of lean protein. Red Rooster.
I feel like you're giving the people too many options. They're going to be sitting in the car forever now. Which one do I go to?
I hope someone pulled over for this list.
Yeah, that's right. There's heaps, guys, honestly.
So I'm not going to... Like, it's 6 pages.
Yeah, 6 pages long. I was just giving them a run through. Just giving them that.
Enjoy my afternoon's work, guys. Seriously. Jump on, download it.
Get it.
Get amongst it.
And you know what is a good option?
Subway.
Ironic story. Bit of a mention to coffee as well. Thanks to Glee Coffee again as well for the fantastic brew we're having at the moment.
Yeah, I wish I had Glee Coffee on the road, that's for sure.
If only. How about a drive through Glee?
That would be fantastic.
A drive through Glee.
I would be there. It'd be heaps better than the whack drive through McDonald's when you tell them that you need soy milk and not regular milk because you're lactose intolerant and they give it to you right off the driveway, full cream milk. Come on,
you
guys.
You were asking for that. You were asking for that trouble.
Why? Because I asked for soy?
Yes.
They're only 14 years old. Give them a break.
Yeah,
they're only 14 year old.
They're teens. They don't care.
They wasn't around.
Soy milk needs.
And I should have been like, hey, guys, I just want to taste this in front of you to see if it's really soy. Drink it. Fall on the ground grabbing my neck. See, this is a lesson to you guys, you 14 year old.
Exactly.
And Glee would not do that if they had a drive through.
Glee wouldn't do that.
They would appreciate their customers and they would give me what I asked for.
Glee cares.
Glee cares.
Glee
That's
cares
right.
about your soy needs.
I don't even like soy. I'm all about almond. But they don't have almond at fast food.
They're taking nuts instead of beans. But as an option, water's going to be the first one. But, if you're having a coffee through the drive-thru, it's always going to be a better option than a soft drink.
Yeah.
Always going to be better. There's nothing I can say to save soft drinks.
Especially, I think you mentioned a while back that coffee is actually
if you didn't mention it, I read it somewhere, that coffee is actually a decent option as a pregame.
Absolutely.
Rather than those eyeball itching, whatever you call them.
Pre-workouts.
Pre-workouts, yeah.
Well, the max you can get, well, actually, you can ask for extra shots and things, so that'll extend it a little bit. But, you know, you're going to be about 270, 300 milligrams of caffeine in one of the largest cups of coffee.
Yeah, right.
And, yeah, so enhanced focus, decreased rate of perceived exertion. And, you know, if you want to shift some of the stuff that's on the hips queue, it can mobilize some body fat for you. It can. For some people, it can increase fat oxidation, but that's a story.
See, I hear so many benefits about coffee, but for me, because I have ADHD, it actually makes me less focused. I'm usually zooming and messes with my acid reflex. So, but I love coffee, so I'm not going to stop. And my teeth are yellow because of it. So shout out to you, coffee makers. Are you fantastic baristas? A barista.
Barista.
Awesome. Anything else, Jase? I feel like that's a lot of nuggets for them to grab onto, but any parting words for those travelers looking to get a healthier option after a game?
If you read the ingredients list and you don't recognize any of the names on there, it's a pretty safe option to steer clear of it. the shorter, the better, basically. Again, size matters. So.
Absolutely. Well, that's another thing out here that you guys don't add fake dyes or colors. So you guys don't have yellow five or any of those things in your...
Not anymore.
Yeah, right. It's something recent.
Yeah, it sends people off the wall.
Yeah. Well, that's good. I was listening to a podcast. I know all this stuff about the difference between Australia and America in regards to food.
There's another six pack of nuggets right there. We've got a few more we can delve into, I reckon, in another podcast.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
So thanks again, Jase. Love when you're on the show. He is our health and nutritional expert. As you guys can clearly hear when he speaks, he's an expert at what he does. So we love having Jase on. We had the Suicide Squad on today. It was fun. New group of
great.
I don't think we've all been on a podcast together. This is exciting, guys. Yeah. I like this.
I think we need Dave back.
No, Dave, stay wherever you are. You've been replaced.
Europeans.
I just feel like he's going to bust in the door and like start yelling, no.
Oh, yeah.
Rip someone out of the chair. Sit down.
Lose the cowboy hat in the process.
Oh, gosh.
That's right.
Has his like little gun out.
The space cowboy. Els, great having you on the show as well.
Thanks for having me.
Social media guru. We're excited. A lot of great things coming here at the end of the year, going into next year, and Ellie's going to be all over it. So make sure you guys stay tuned to the website, Grassroots Sports, and make sure you guys head over and subscribe to the newsletter. Everything you see there is brought to you by Ellie, so super excited for that. Also super excited for what NSA has going on at the end of the year and moving into to next year. So, hey guys, we want to thank you, especially all you Earth movers out there, because I noticed that there's some podcasts out there who you would think have better ratings than us and who had a lot, like they have like hundreds of episodes, and it's a pretty popular person who's the host of the podcast. And I go to the reviews and iTunes says, sorry, we cannot display reviews because there's not enough here. That means there's absolutely zero. So you guys who are leaving us comments and leaving us reviews, thank you so much. That just shows how much you guys care and how much you guys want to share the information and content that we have been producing for you guys. So big shout out to you guys. Thanks so much. Continue to leave feedback, continue to hang out with us on all of our social media platforms. If you're watching on YouTube, make sure you subscribe to the red button below. If you're listening to iTunes, please subscribe and leave us a comment. Let us know what you think. Also, hang out with us on Twitter at @grassroots_AU, Instagram at @grassroots_sports, and facebook.com/grassrootssports. Till next time, guys, you're hanging out with us in Thought Fox Studio 1, also known as the Fox Den.